People of the truth faith that will show up on a night like tonight. But we know why you're here, to hear from Dr. Ed Ayers. Incredible story, incredible accomplishments. President of the University of Richmond from 2007 to 2015, won a tiny little award, the National Humanities Medal, presented by President Obama at the White House in 2013. Author of 4 books, editor of 7, several prizes, Bancroft Prize, also finalist for the National Book Award and the Pulitzer Prize. Has degrees from many interesting places, Yale University, but one in particular that we share, that I'm a great fan of. It's so nice in this part of the world to have someone that is a graduate of the University of Tennessee. Go Vols, go Vols. So with no further ado,
So if you were a class, you'd be getting extra credit for coming out tonight. So I'll just give you credit now for being good sports. And to come out and talk about the mystery of the Civil War, I think that's an act of faith right there, you know. It's kind of like a box of Cracker Jacks. You know, what's this mystery thing that he's talking about? And you know, the last 5 years have been an interesting time to be in my line of work at the history business. Always interesting to be a president, but the history business part of it, because of the sesquicentennial. We've had lots and lots of opportunities, and I think this is sort of my last opportunity of this sort. That Reconstruction now is spinning up, and I'm getting calls to come talk about that and to do TV shows. I was invited yesterday by the Huffington Post to do a podcast with Killer Mike, who's a hip-hop DJ, so I hope so. We'll see what that is, if I end up doing that or not. But, you know, so I had the chance to speak at Charleston on the anniversary of the firing of Fort Sumter and Antietam that anniversary when it was 110 degrees, and I was under a tent with a fan, and my wife was sitting in completely unprotected. It's a horrifying memory. I don't really want to do that. And then Gettysburg, and then, of course, being in Richmond. And so, in some ways, tonight's talk is sort of a reflection on those talks, on the reactions and responses that we've received. And, you know, it's obviously still a live wire in American culture. There's nothing that has really got people as upset over the last 6 months as things in the wake of the Charleston shootings and the Confederate battle flag and the monuments in Richmond and the license plates and all those kinds of things. And this is a shameless plug, but I'll go ahead and tell you that anyway. Our radio show, we have a nationally syndicated radio show called Backstory with American History Guys, and Saturday show is about this. And we interview a really interesting array of people, from the flaggers who stand outside the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts and wave the flag, to Michael Paul Williams, editorial writer in the Times-Dispatch, who says it's time to take down the monuments. And we talk to people about all the range in between. And I'll tell you, it strikes me that the press only has not done a good job with this. Mm-hmm. It's either one side or the other. Right? You don't ever hear about anybody changing their mind. Right? So what we're going to talk about tonight is not that directly, even though I've had to talk about anything you want to talk about in the question and answer, but rather the Civil War itself. And one reason that we can keep arguing about this 150 years later is that we still don't really understand what the Civil War was. And since we don't agree on what it was, we can argue about it indefinitely. Now, it does create job security. and I do have this whole plate of brownies and things that I'm taking advantage of when I drive back to Charlottesville tonight. But so tonight I want to actually think about how we figure out what the Civil War was. I mean, people will still just disagree about what it was over, why people fought, what it resolved and didn't resolve. And it strikes me we should be able to come closer to figuring out than we have. So we might begin with a recognition that seems so simple that everybody in the era of the Civil War thought they were doing things that made sense. Nobody was acting what they thought was irrational. So our job is to go back and reconstruct what people thought they were doing. So I have just a few things to show you at the beginning here that are different ways that we've tried at the University of Richmond to figure out really what happened. So if you look at, for example, at counties won in a popular vote, you see what a mess this was. Four different candidates, 1860. The yellow is the Constitutional Union Party. And they say, hey, we like things exactly as they are. Slavery is safe. So you look at this, you'll see the Mississippi Delta and the Georgia Black Belt and large parts of Virginia that are saying, we're leaving things alone, right? So that kind of confuses us right off the bat, because you think it's really people who want to fight the abolitionists who can't wait to secede. And you also see that, but in all these purple areas are places that slavery is not particularly strong, but they vote for the strong secession candidates. And here's this brand new party, Republican Party. And for those of us about at least my age or older, I point out this is as if Ross Perot won the next election. That's how new this party was, for it to come out of nowhere and then to have this. And so this is one part of the confusion. Okay, what did the people who voted to save the United States 6 months later, how did they secede? So that's one kind of mystery. And this one kind of helps us figure it out. So turns out that Virginia didn't secede for months and months after South Carolina and the other Deep South states did. And they said, we hate South Carolina for putting us in this position. It's very sensitive. And I clearly asked for you to turn down my accent and to turn up the bass, and I don't hear either one, but I don't know what they go. And so Virginia says, we're not like South Carolina or Georgia. We're the mother of democracy. So what we're going to do is have every county send delegates to Richmond, and we'll debate this and figure out what we should do. And they think that they are actually going to save the United States. Most of the delegates who are sent there are voting for, are sent there to save the Union. And so, because they talked about it so long, local newspaper reporters wrote down all the words that they said and ended up filling 3,000 pages of books. So when I knew the sesquicentennial was coming along at UR, we got the Library of Virginia to let us completely slice one of those up. We digitized it all so that people can actually look and see what they said. And one of the things that you hear people say all the time, well, it was just economics. Anybody who begins their answer with just, they're wrong, okay? Anybody who has one answer of what it was just. So you look for tariff. So you can see it automatically generates a map of where they talk about tariff. You see they mentioned tariff 87 times, 81 times. So, but did they talk about slavery? Because you'll hear a lot of people say it was states' rights. And let's see if they mentioned slavery. Yeah, 1,432 times. Of course they were talking about slavery. And they would have been amazed that later generations would pretend that they weren't. And they were talking about rights? Well, of course they are. What right? The right to determine our own future as a slaveholding society. And so, but they realize if you're in Virginia, if you go to war, if you join this new Confederacy, which you're not sure you want to do, if you do, let's imagine where the war is going to be. And so when they end up finally, not just after Fort Sumter, but after Lincoln says, you have to choose. You either have to send troops to put down rebellion in South Carolina, or you're not. And they said, no, we're not. But they were crying, some of them. And they knew what they were getting ready to unleash on Virginia. So Virginia had to be dragged kicking and screaming into the Confederacy. And ironically, the bonus was to become the capital, which meant you're also becoming the target of 4 years of war. So you're seeing already the war's not even begun yet, and there's all of these strange patterns. And then we made this one, which is, I'll just run a little bit and then stop it. The blue dots that are gonna start emerging up in the top are United States units. And those of you who are Civil War aficionados will know about the official records of the War of the Rebellion, 128 volumes that have all these records. We went through and digitized them all, And we can tell you where every unit in the United States Army was every 2 weeks in the war. And so you can actually sort of, it's like Space Invaders, you sort of watch them descend on the south. But what the map was really about are all the red dots. And that's every place that African Americans came in contact with the United States Army. And so we're only up to 1862, and you should be stuck right now by the fact that, wow, there's already a lot of stuff happening between African Americans and the United States Army. So it turns out that the story that we think of, that they were fighting and then Abraham Lincoln says, you're free, and then they became free, is nothing like reality either. This is the first time we've ever been able to see this. We didn't know what pattern they would show. We just made the map, and it turns out that slavery is ending lots of places very early, and we'll talk about that in just a minute. So you can see the patterns that I'm talking about here. It's most of the things that happened in the war are not straightforward. So unless the Democrats split and put two candidates in the field in 1860, Abraham Lincoln, who only wins 40% of the vote, has no chance of winning. So who calls the Civil War? The Democrats. Or without that election of Lincoln, there's no secession, including no secession of Virginia, North Carolina, and Tennessee. If you don't have those states, the Confederacy is not nearly big enough to be able to wage war for 4 years. And without the rush of enslaved people, very near here, to whatever freedom they could find at Fortress Monroe, 3 weeks after Virginia secedes. Now you all know here, the oldest part of Virginia, by the time of the Civil War, slavery had existed in Virginia longer than we are from the Civil War today. Okay? And even though it had been here 200 years, within 3 weeks, three African-American men go to Fort Monroe and said, we're on your side. Slavery begins to unravel instantly. And anywhere the United States troops go, not because they're trying to free the slaves at this point, but because slaves are trying to free themselves, using, finally, somebody who might be an ally. You look at this carefully, it turns out a lot of times they weren't allies. We can talk about that later if you want to. So without that, you don't have the United States Army being forced to say you're contraband and creating a policy by whereby it made sense for enslaved people to go to the United States Army. Then, without the failed Peninsula Campaign, goes right through here in 1862, there's no widely perceived need for emancipation. The Union soldiers who are right here, right back home, and they say, well, Mom, these black people are as Christian as you and me. And a lot of them are as smart as you and me. And they want to be free. And they are the ones who are digging all the field works. We're dying against earthworks dug by enslaved men. We're going to have to destroy slavery if we're going to destroy the South. And when they get to Richmond, they really see that's the path. Then, if you don't have a narrow victory at Antietam, then Lincoln has no opportunity to put out the Emancipation Proclamation when he does. If you don't have that, you don't have 200,000 African-American soldiers joining the United States, more than all the soldiers at Gettysburg of both armies combined, because of the timing of that. And with no narrow victory in July, there probably would not have been Republican victories in October, which in turn laid the necessary foundations for Republican victory the next year. So then you have all the way through, without Atlanta falling in the late summer of early fall of 1864, and without the Shenandoah Valley falling, Abraham Lincoln's not going to be reelected. The other thing you can look at here in this regard is this. Amazing fact, 1864, Abraham Lincoln wins the same percentage of the vote that he won in 1860. 45% of white voting men won't vote for Abraham Lincoln in the middle of the Civil War. So people who know about, say, Franklin Roosevelt in World War II, how people rallied behind him, not Abraham Lincoln in the Civil War. So whenever people from the North want to be self-righteous about this, or nearly half of you would not vote for Abraham freaking Lincoln in 1864, okay? It's not automatic that this is happening, okay? So as late as this, the Civil War could have turned out differently, the result of it could have turned out differently. So in other words, why does slavery end? It ended because The only way it could possibly have ended is the Southern states fled the protection of the Constitution by seceding. At the time of the Civil War, slavery is, in the United States, is the largest and most powerful system of slavery in the modern world. The enslaved population is worth all, more than all the railroads and banks and factories of the North combined. The South by itself is the fourth richest economy in the world. What's the largest slave state? Virginia. Virginia is still the largest slave state in 1860, and it is the future of what slavery would look like. Drive up 64 to Richmond, and you would have seen what the future of slavery would have been. Slaves working in ironworks, tobacco factories, on railroads, that's what the future of slavery is going to look like. Slavery had never been stronger than it was in 1860. So slavery is not going to fade away. So the only way it could possibly have come to an end is if the South basically commits suicide by seceding. Then the only way that slavery could come to an end is because of Robert E. Lee and Stonewall Jackson. If they had let McClellan take Richmond in 62, the end of slavery had not been declared as a purpose of the North at that time. The Civil War would have ended and slavery would not have. But instead, the Confederates were so good at waging war, they fought so long that slavery was destroyed as a result. So you see, none of these things are the way that people imagine all this, right? And it's just, all it is, it's like, let's just take the facts, the patterns, and look at them. So the fact is that soldiers did not scream for or against slavery on the battlefield. So how is it that slavery runs throughout this entire war, but it's not very much in the letters and diaries of the people who are fighting for and against it? That's something I know from a lot of people that I will talk to who say, well, Ed, it can't be about slavery. A, three-fourths of white Southerners didn't own slaves. And B, certainly my ancestors didn't, they usually say. And it's also the case that they didn't say they were fighting for slavery. So that is a kind of a mystery, okay? But the fact is that everybody knew that the entire South was built entirely on slavery, whether you were a slaveholder or not. So we can talk about all these things that you want to. So the fact is that nobody, I think it's fair to say, if you told them in 1860 that in 10 years, 4 million people are going to have been freed from slavery with no compensation to the slaveholders, and the men among that population will be voting and writing a new constitution for Virginia. That's impossible. The entire Civil War was impossible. It just happened. Okay? And so the idea that anybody, Frederick Douglass, Robert E. Lee, Abraham Lincoln, had any idea any of that was going to happen is just not true. So we have to figure out, okay, how did those mysterious things do it? So the easiest way is to pretend that's not a mystery at all. Well, the North had a lot more stuff, Professor Ayers. They were going to win eventually. Everybody knows that slavery can't exist in the modern world. It was going to fade away eventually. It was really just about economics. No, none of those things are true. World history would have been entirely different had the American Civil War not occurred when it did, and the largest, most powerful system of slavery in the modern world ended when it did. There's nothing inevitable about a single part of all this. So, a mystery, I mean like in a mystery novel. There are clues, sometimes right in front of our noses. There are puzzles that we can unravel. There's lots of evidence. And then it's in a mystery novel, if you think about how it is that they solve them, you go back and think about what was it like at the moment of the crime? What could they have known or seen? Remember Monk, great show, yeah. And try to picture exactly what they could have seen. Well, that's kind of what we need to do. Everybody acted from partial knowledge and flawed logic. No one at the time saw the battles and elections as we do. Nobody saw Gettysburg. They saw the person on the other side of that log shooting at them, and they were shooting them back. Robert E. Lee did not see Gettysburg. If he had, it would have turned out differently. And so we need to remember, okay, if we're going to understand it, we actually need to get down on the ground and see what people could see, not float up above it, godlike, passing judgment on these stupid people of the past. But rather get down and say, whoa, okay, I see what you're thinking. From your perspective on that day in this place, I can see why you did the things that you did. So if we're going to understand them, we have to kind of walk among them and see their logic. And so the other thing you need to understand is that the entire era is an elaborate counterpoint. The North is doing what it does because the South is doing what it is doing. So it's this elaborate dance. And both are acting mainly from what they think the other one is thinking. And you go back and read their newspapers at exactly the same time, and they both are just wrong. They both think the other one's getting ready to give up just any day now. They both think that the other one's going to break apart any day now. And that's Lincoln's mistake at the beginning. He just cannot imagine that people like Virginians, who created this country only 70 years before this, would walk away from it. He can't believe that people would do that. And he miscalculated. And then the South miscalculates that enslaved people are going to stay right where they are, even if they had the opportunity to be free. So you got to picture everything in movement all the time. So I'm just going to give you one example of what this kind of looks like. I'm going to put my glasses on. We're going to talk about what people would generally consider to be 272 greatest words ever spoken by an American, that kids memorize them now, that we imagine are somehow floating above history. But let's see where they actually came from. So it's the fall of 1863, and men were laboring to turn the scarred land around Gettysburg into a national cemetery. Quote, the new cemetery contains about 10 acres of ground and is located less than half a mile southwest of town. By the end of November, quote, only a portion of our dead, the work of reinterment, not been completed. The receptacles are ditches, mostly from 20 to 100 feet long, with proper width, and walled with stone. In every instance where the dead are known, headboards are placed properly inscribed. Find that people don't really wrap their minds around the fact that if the Civil War occurred today and killed the same proportion of our population, it would be 8.8 million people. Okay? You know, I have to admit, I noticed that people patronize people who are interested in the Civil War buffs. You know, you talk about something that's 8.8 million people equivalent dying, that changes all world history. It's not a trivial enterprise. We don't talk about World War II buffs. We can talk about Civil War buffs and patronize people. This is a momentous and heartbreaking episode. The battle had already assumed a central place in the nation's understanding of the war. This was the place where the United States had defended itself on its own ground from those who would invade, dishonor, and dismember it. It was the place where northern men had been killed on northern soil, where the grateful nation could demonstrate its gratitude and respect. And that's why today the largest Civil War museum in the country is at Gettysburg. I'm chairman of the board of the new American Civil War Museum in Richmond. And I just point out that they had 4 days of the Civil War, we had 4 years. And ironically, it's a lot easier to tell the story of 4 days than it is of 4 years. But we're the center of the American slave trade, and we're the center of the American Civil War. 40% of all men who died in the Civil War, northern or southern, died within 150 miles of Richmond. A lot of them right around here. So that's where the American Civil War Museum should be. We're combining the Museum of the Confederacy and the American Civil War Center and partnering with the Virginia Historical Society. So we're hoping we'll have to use it pretty soon. But there's no place in the country where you can see the entire story of the American Civil War. Can't see the story of black and white, male and female, northern and southern, civilian and soldier, all together. That's what we're trying to do in Richmond. So the guy putting this all together goes out and gets the greatest speaker in the country. It's Edward Everett, of course, who is former President Hardin, confidant of President Lincoln, and he had all the skills that people were looking for orator in the 19th century. He was powerful, learned, and passionate, and he would come there and tell the story of the battle. That's what he was supposed to do. And the guy invited other dignitaries, and President Lincoln accepted an invitation only a few days before he was supposed to go. And this was the longest trip he took outside of Washington during his entire presidency. And he thought it would be a kind of a vacation for his wife and himself. But their son became ill. They'd lost another son just a year before, and she was not willing to leave. And so he took the train from Washington to Gettysburg by himself, stopping along the way to politic. And when he was invited to make a few, quote, appropriate remarks, which meant several things. One, they were not to be long. Everett had long been announced as the main speaker, and he could talk as long as he wanted to. And he would. Second, the remarks would need to focus on the work at hand. This is basically a funeral oration. And third, they had to be nonpartisan. He couldn't come in and be beating the drum for the Republican Party. Lincoln knew all these things, said, I accept that. I'm just a sort of accessory, but I'm happy to come. And one reason he took it is because the Union purpose in the fall of 1863 needed reaffirmation. Events from the war had occurred so rapidly, they just piled on top of them with defeat and loss. Now think about this. You're only 6 months from the humiliation of Chancellorsville by the time that Lincoln's given the Gettysburg Address, right? Only a time where the Union just flat out fails. But you're closer in time to Gettysburg and Vicksburg falling, but you're only 6 weeks from Chickamauga, one of the great Confederate victories in the entire Civil War. So Lincoln is not going there to give a talk at this pretty cemetery. When I was there one time, Boy Scouts were there, and I heard one Boy Scout ask a ranger, so did they shoot from behind all these monuments? which is actually good to remember that that's not, these battlefields were just farms. And they didn't have all these names. They didn't have a lot of names that we even call them now until after the fact. But it was just raw. There's still coffins stacked at the train station when Lincoln arrives, and the bodies haven't even been reburied. The United States has met with as much defeat as it has victory in recent months. But we imagine this is all being, everybody imagines the past like the Pepperidge Farm commercial. It was all kind of neater and cleaner, and oh man, the Civil War was nasty. I've spent a lot of my days writing about it, and it's like I'm so glad to live in the 20th century, 21st century. And even as Lincoln's train is arriving in Gettysburg, other trains are rushing all kinds of men and material of war down to Chattanooga. They're expecting a battle larger than Gettysburg. So that's building even as Lincoln's getting ready to give the Gettysburg Address. Now, back then they had, it's kind of like Virginia, how we have all these off-year elections. They had big ones back then, and Republicans had won in Pennsylvania, New York, and Ohio, but the largest Republican state's Pennsylvania, and they barely won. They wouldn't have won if they hadn't been able to drive Lee out a little bit earlier than they did, because they hated the governor for letting their Confederates come right into Pennsylvania. And they hated the Republicans for letting them come right into Pennsylvania. Fortunately, Gettysburg allowed the governor to be called the soldier's friend, and the Republicans win. If they don't win that, Lincoln already knows that he is on really thin ice. He does not think in August of 1864 that he's going to be renominated by his own party. So that's how tenuous all this is. We look back on the Gettysburg Address and imagine that it's kind of almost a glorious affirmation of victory. But there's no victory in the air in November of 1863. He's worried that if Sherman's not able to do something down in Georgia, and even if Meade just can't move Lee here in Virginia, that the North may just say, we've given you enough of our sons and our brothers and our fathers. Let's let it go. So that's, the entire Civil War hangs with the election of 1864 over the whole thing. That's the turning point of the Civil War, is the election of 1864. So everybody memorizes all the battles and stuff, and they're so important. The elections turn around the battles, but the battles also turn around the elections as well. Now, Lincoln had a couple of other speeches coming up. He was going to give his annual address to Congress less than 2 weeks later, and therefore he was going to be talking about all the nuts and bolts of the war. His job now was to say words of respect for 3,000 men who had died there. Jacob Hoke, a 38-year-old dry goods merchant who visited the Gettysburg battlefield right after the battle, came back from this and brought his wife Margaret. And he was awestruck by everything he saw. He saw Abraham Lincoln in an inn, and the people come out and cheer, and he comes out and he says, came out, when Lincoln's face relaxed its appearance of careworn sadness and anxiety, and a kind and genial smile overspread his countenance. He then said that Miguel expected a speech, and that he would be happy to gratify us, but he dare not do it, for Mr. Seward would not let it. So he could only thank us for the respect shown him and bid us all good night. So the good-natured crowd cheered him, and then Mr. Seward came out and gave a speech, the guy said, of considerable length. So even back then, you guys handlers, Mr. President, you know, you got a big day tomorrow, we don't be giving a speech. But I have one, however, that I'd love to give. So the next day, Lincoln somberly tours the battlefield. He joins the procession at the speaker's stand. So many people gather around him to shake his hand and slow down the whole process. The crowd was immense and gathered so compactly that it was almost impossible to breathe. Several people fainted, and the value of hoops, bonnets, and other articles of ladywear destroyed in the jam would amount to no ordinary sum. So, it's men and women together, you hear that wheelbone snapping. So then America's greatest orator, Edward Everett, stands up, rose, for 2 hours, held the crowd in one of the most splendid intellectual efforts of his life. So we're going to do that tonight in honor. And he did what he was supposed to. He told about what had happened all around. Then it was time for Lincoln. And he rose, and the visitor says, and amidst the thunder of artillery, I never thought about that. They're firing artillery before he gives the Gettysburg address. And the tremendous applause of the immense multitude advanced to the front of the platform, his tall, gaunt form and sad but amiable face within the view of thousands who beheld the memorable scene. When the crowd finally grew quiet, you gotta remember, no amplification at all. So the number of people who actually heard the Gettysburg Address is probably not a whole lot larger than this room. He didn't have a lavalier mic though. And when he finally grew quiet, he, quote, proceeded in slow and measured tones to deliver his dedicatory address. Even though people could not hear it, the most profound silence was observed. 272 words, punctuated 5 times by applause. What did he do? He humbled himself and everyone else there in front of the man who died. So you guys kind of remember the Gettysburg Address, right? Okay. Well, he's saying what you would say at a funeral. Right? This is not about us. This is about the men who gave their lives here. And he reminded everybody that the Battle of Gettysburg, for all its grandeur and glory, had not brought the war to an end. In fact, if you think about what the speech is actually about, it's about all the unfinished work that still lies before the United States. It was for the living to, quote, be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us. It was for the living, quote, to take increased devotion. It was for the living to, quote, highly resolve the dead shall not have died in vain. So this is not about looking back. The Gettysburg Address is about we've got to redeem this suffering. We've got to redeem this loss. We've got to press on. So even though we think of it as somber and quiet, it's basically saying we can't pause. The visitor says that when he emphasized with a brief pause and a significant nodding and jerking of his head that the government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth. So all these things come together. And when the response afterward was, the Democrats said, you know, it wasn't really that much of a speech, was it? The things that people say about Abraham Lincoln are so much harsher than things that people are saying about President Obama now. The things that people said about Abraham Lincoln just take a breath away. And the Democrats said this is an inappropriate speech. It was basically partisan. He's got his eyes on the elections coming up. He shouldn't have been there. We had Edward Everett did the work that should have been done. Republicans said, no, it was a good speech. But the fact is, had the battles that followed it not turned out as they did, American school kids wouldn't be memorizing this speech. We already know Gary Wills won the Pulitzer Prize talking about the speech that changed America. I wonder, no, it didn't. It wasn't even famous until the 1920s. You know, when we really were sure this was all secure. But none of this diminishes it. If we think about the point is to understand why people were doing things in the moment that they did them, even the Gettysburg Address fits that. The Gettysburg Address doesn't make sense unless you understand that Chickamauga was only 6 weeks before. Unless you understand that there's a real danger that the Republicans might not be in power to finish the war. But there's real danger that the next president of the United States could be George McClellan, who was calling for peace with the South. The Gettysburg Address is greater than we think because it was trapped in that moment of time, because he was negotiating in very subtle ways the challenges around him at that very moment. But that same context helps explain something a lot of people puzzled over and worried about. Never mentions slavery. He never mentions slavery by name. The great emancipator, in his greatest speech, doesn't mention the thing for which we build statues for him. And Edward Everett only mentions slavery 7 times. And when he does, he mentions it to blame slaveholders for causing the war that killed the young men whose funeral they were acknowledging. So people can look at this and say, and there's reasons people can do this, and say that the North, they were hypocrites. They did not go to war to end slavery. And that's true. The North did not start the Civil War to bring slavery to an end. I've already told you that was impossible. There was no way that you could conquer an area the size of continental Europe with 4 million people held in slavery, with strong allies in England and France. It couldn't be done. So how is it in 18 months that it does? I told you. So McClellan couldn't take Richmond. They realized that if they were going to win, they're going to have to do this. But they also realized that the people in slavery wanted desperately to be free. But 3 weeks before he gave the Gettysburg Address, Lincoln wrote a letter to people who were having a convention back in Illinois. And he told them, listen, here's a few things. You're dissatisfied with me about the Negro. I certainly wish all men could be free, he says. Well, I suppose you do not. His critics hated the Emancipation Proclamation. That's hard for us to imagine, but a lot of people said, you just lost the Civil War. The Emancipation Proclamation is going to make the White South fight now until there's nobody left. You've just given away any possibility of peace and probably any chance of winning the war. He says, you hate the Emancipation Proclamation, arguing that freeing the slaves prolonged the war. But, quote, some of the commanders of our armies in the field who have given us our important successes believe the emancipation policy and the use of colored troops constitute the heaviest blow yet dealt to the rebellion. Then he says, you say you will not fight to free Negroes. Some of them seem willing to fight for you, but no matter. He was great at sarcasm. And there was he's basically saying white men are not as good as white men who would argue this, that they're not going to fight for them. They're fighting for you, but no matter. Like other people, black Americans, Lincoln reminded his opponents, act upon motives. Why should they do anything for us if we will do nothing for them? If they stake their lives for us, they must be prompted by the strongest motive, even the promise of freedom. And the promise being made must be kept. He says that these black men who are fighting and dying to save the United States are helping mankind onto this great consummation of freedom with silent tongue and clenched teeth and steady eye and well-poised bayonet. So none of the language in the Gettysburg Address has got bayonets and clenched, it's a funeral. But just a few weeks before, he's writing and saying, black men are probably saving the United States. And there's a lot of truth to that. If you didn't have 200,000 African American soldiers, what would the rest of the Civil War look like? But in the Gettysburg Address, there is something new. He talks there for the first time at great length of union rather than nation. He begins to say, the point is not really to unify us, but we are a single nation, and we have always been. This nation down in the South is still a part of our union, and they will come back. He always had the idea that there was one union, only one true union, and it required all the states. The other thing that he did is he elevated the word equality to a long liberty. So Lincoln does not mention the word slavery, but by talking about a new birth of freedom and talking about equality, he is kind of sneaking in new language to all this. If you don't know the time when he's doing this and what puzzle he's trying to solve with it, these words just sound kind of good, but you don't really know what they are actually saying. So this new language of nation and equality, wrapped in biblical imagery and cadence, consecrated by solemn warning, managed to sound ageless from the moment that Lincoln uttered it. But he admitted that they would have to have a new birth of freedom. It's not that the nation had been newly born. It would have to have a new birth of freedom. Now, as great as the speech would reveal itself to be over time, when the words had been parsed and memorized by generations, when the war's outcome made them seem pressing, at the time, they were just one more speech. In the meantime, politics back then were as ugly as they are today. Just not televised, but they were as desperate and ugly as they are. And the main thing that Lincoln had to worry about, not only the armies in the field in the South, but the Democrats at the voting booth in the North. So here's the thing. You know, so I'm kind of a cheerful guy. I get up every day and think about the worst things in American history for a living. Think about slavery for a living. Think about the suffering of the war every day for a living. Think about Reconstruction and lynching and segregation and disfranchisement for a living. It's a strange thing to do. Why? Because unless we actually confront all of this, it's going to keep haunting us the way that it does now. If we just try to sweep it under the rug or come up with an easy answer about why this is not what it appears to be, it's just going to come back. 150 years is a long time to be arguing about something. Wouldn't you say? Right? I don't see probably pretty many British visitors to Williamsburg, and I bet they're not often accosted or challenged. And I'm probably not carrying the Union Jack to the streets of Williamsburg, but. But we still argue about this. And you would think that if we would see it more clearly, we might be able to find grounds of agreement. But the thing is, too, I already told you about the 12.8 billion people. The amount of suffering in the war, we can't possibly hold in our heads. If we could see what one day of it was like, we couldn't stand it. And so it's perhaps not surprising that we'd rather turn into a few slogans rather than to really think about how horrible it was. And the other thing, just to think about how close we came to it not turning out as it did. There were lots of times when the South could have won. And on this radio show on Saturday, somebody says, I wish with all my heart the South would. Imagine what world history would have looked like if you'd had the fourth richest economy. Forget what caused the Civil War. Forget why people fought. Let's just imagine the Confederacy wins. You had the fourth richest economy in the world based on perpetual bondage, producing the single most valuable commodity in the world, cotton, the oil of the 19th century. What would world history have looked like if you'd had into the 20th century, that being the model of what economic development could look like? What would have happened in Latin America? What would have happened in Cuba, Brazil, which abolished slavery after the United States? It's Think about what was at stake. So the temptation is to rush the story along. My sense that every textbook in America has the same chart at the beginning that shows how much more stuff the North had than the South did. Right? Everybody likes that. If you're a Northerner, you'd like it because it shows how much more stuff you had. And if you're a Southerner, it shows you, well, they had so much more stuff, of course they won. Right? Standards of learning for Virginia say something like the North had more stuff and the South had better generals. Well, we can talk about that if you want to. So the Civil War itself is complicated, and then you try to figure out how something that either side said they went to war to do, which is end slavery, happened. So one way I think about this, it's like an unbalanced equation. The North did not go to war to end slavery, but the South did go to war to protect it. That's just an undeniable fact. You can look at all 3,000 pages of all that, and they would have been surprised that people would argue the contrary. But how then is it? And this is where this chart that I showed before comes up. So it's going all the way back to the beginning. I did not necessarily intend for it to do that, but this will play while I finish my remarks. By the time of the Civil War, about 500,000 enslaved people had come within the reach of the United States Army. That means 3.5 million had not. So when the Civil War ends, it's by no means clear what the end of slavery is going to mean. Now there's two ways of looking at this, many more than two ways of looking at it, but here's one way to think about it, is that no other slaveholding society in the world ever went through as wrenching a change as the American South. To go from a fully functioning, healthy slave society into one where it was completely gone in 5 years. No other slave society underwent anything like Reconstruction, in which you have formerly enslaved men living. No other formerly enslaved population in the world has been as successful as African Americans. No other formerly enslaved population in world history has been as successful as African Americans. How were they successful? By 1910, 80% of all black Virginians who lived in the country owned their own farms. 70% had become literate. How many black churches have you seen all around Virginia that were founded in the wake of all this? How many schools were founded? The story is not of just the failure of Reconstruction, but of the success of African Americans becoming free with nothing but the shirts on their backs, and with every law stacked against them, segregation, of disfranchisement, to be able to build the lives that they have. So we try to, and this is how complicated the Civil War is. It's not big air, red and blue arrows or red and blue boxes, and it's not just confined to a battlefield, but instead it's sweeping up this entire area. So in many ways, our current struggles in Missouri and on campuses, all the fights surrounding the Confederate battle flag, show that the consequences of the American Civil War are still unfolding. We're still really debating how powerful should the federal government be in relationship to the states, which is in many ways the constitutional issues of the war. What responsibility do people have who benefited from 300, over 200 years of unpaid labor on the people? What kind of responsibilities do we have for 100 years of segregation? Those are questions that are still hanging in the air. And the lessons that I draw from all this are just two for ourselves today.